Hello.
Hi, guys.
Abby got a new phone, so we feel like fancy.
We're so fancy.
We feel really fancy right now. Welcome
to
Friday with Friends. Friday with Friends is our opportunity to talk about what's going on in the market so that if you have any real estate needs or any real estate questions, we would love the opportunity to be your realtor of choice. We love what we do and we love helping. So today, hi Zia, hi Dave.
Hi guys.
Hi Jennifer.
Hi Stephanie.
So what we're talking about today is...
We have an awesome day planned today. So today we're talking about showings. Mm-hmm. And what is a showing? What do we look for? What is a typical showing look like? Because I think that's one thing that a lot of people just assume. Oh, you walk through the house. You think, yeah. I like this, I like that, I don't like this, I don't like that. But really, there's so much more that goes into it.
And especially in this market, like in the good old days.
The olden days.
You would walk into a house and you'd be like, you know what? I think I like it. I'm going to come back for a second showing. Like you don't have that luxury right now in this market. You need, like, every single showing you're at is crucial, because not only are you probably not getting a second showing, you need to really know how confident am I in writing a really, really strong offer. Maybe one that's over asking price, maybe one that's waiving inspection. We do not recommend that, but we do have it happen. So you really need to make sure that you're taking advantage of every second you have in the house, looking for the right things, knowing what you can open up, what you don't want to open up, all of those things, or not even don't want to, but like you shouldn't.
You're feeling like you want to be a little creepy. Don't open these.
Exactly. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're pumped about
it. Awesome. Awesome. So make sure you say hi. Hi, Heidi. When you tune on, it's so funny. It always asks us to tag our mom whenever we come
on. Do you want to tag Sue Henderson, friend?
And we're like, no. Thanks.
But it's good. We look alike, I guess.
Yeah, that's my biggest compliment. So make sure you say hi when you tune in. If you've been looking at houses and you have any things that you said, gosh, this was so important, make sure you comment below.
Yeah.
And if you're watching later, #replay.
#replay so we don't miss any comments if we're not able to see them. All right. Well, great.
Perfect.
Well, let's get into it. Okay, so we've kind of separated it up in three ways. We've said, how do you prepare for a showing? What do you do when you're during the showing?
During.
And
post.
Then after. Sound like a plan?
Yeah,
all right. So what are some things that we should be prepping for? How can we make sure that we're preparing so that we have a successful showing?
Yeah. So first, it's just so important that you have a cert set up with your realtor.
Yes.
What we do in our team and what a lot of agents do is set up MLS searches for our client. This is so important because a lot of times, a lot of people don't know that it actually, once a house hits the market, it's getting quicker, but it can take a day or two for those houses to actually go live on the Zillow's, Trulia, Realtor.com's, mm-hmm. those sites that a lot of buyers are using. So first and foremost, make sure you have that search set up.
Yes, because so many times people think, oh, I'm looking on Realtor.com, I'm looking in these other places, and yes, it's great, they have their info, but you need to be able to make sure you're getting it right away. And then also in that, as compared to some of the other third-party sites, on the MLS, you're able to actually see what, if there's delayed negotiations, if there's open houses, all of those things too. So when you're set up through the MLS, you're able to know, like, do I need to drop everything and get into this? Or, hey, it's delayed negotiations until Sunday after the open house 1-3.
And we have some time.
Yep, some time. And so, you can take a breath and you don't have to leave your son's soccer game.
That would be rushing for
sure. Don't get me started. It's not worth it.
So then once you have an idea of, okay, this house just came through my search, I love it, I really like it, I text my agent, I want to go take a look at it. Another good thing to do is do a drive-by.
Yes.
Maybe you're in the neighborhood, or maybe if you're not, you can look it up on Google, but it's always a good idea to take a look at that.
Yes. Kayla is saying, that's how we got our magical gem. Yes, the email. It was literally like within seconds. It comes in really, really fast.
Our clients get the listings the second that we do.
Yeah. And the second every other realtor does too. So we're talking about drive-bys.
Yes.
So if you know the neighborhood, and a lot of times we have clients, listen, I want to be in this neighborhood. I know it like the back mm-hmm. of my hand. You don't necessarily need to. But now that our clients are starting to expand their search into different cities maybe that they didn't think of or different neighborhoods, it's so important to do that drive-by to see what that neighborhood's like. Now, of course, if you have only a minute, sometimes people even do the Google Maps.
Google Earth.
Google Earth, thank you. Google Earth, where you can start to really get a feel for it and see
it. Like you're taking a walk down the street.
Yes, because us realtors might be really good at showing the best parts. Maybe if there's a house that's really close to the other one. Mm-hmm. Maybe if the backyard backs up to something that you didn't think it backed up to. So the Google Earth will really, really give you that if you do not have that time for the drive-by.
That makes me think of our House Hunters episode with you.
Yes.
When there was that one had like a... literally a drop off
right around a point
in the backyard and
like
by
a
the
cliff
bay.
Guys
yeah
legitimate cliff. That house was beautiful, but like what's the realtor gonna do, be like beautiful cliff in the backyard? Yeah. Like they're not marketing
situated on a small cliff. But yeah, it's always a good idea.
Not ideal for small children.
No. And maybe check out our House Hunters episode.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Cool.
Yes, check that out.
So drive by, really taking a look at the exterior of the house, whether you have the opportunity to drive or walk by, or just looking at the Google is always a great idea.
Yes. So then so once you kind of have that, then before is, it's really good to be able to go through the listing. So sometimes people see the house and they love it, but you need to make sure you're looking at it to see, okay, what are my must-haves? So here's an example. You could say my must-haves are a 3-bedroom, 1.5 bath. But when you look at the MLS listing, it came through, but maybe that half bath might be in the basement.
The basement. And it's a weird toilet just sitting there.
And it's a weird toilet just sitting there. And again, as a realtor, we want to list it, but it's tough to be able to separate that out in the search. That third bedroom could be on the first floor and it's actually an office. So there's so many things that you can be thinking about when you're looking at the MLS. It's important. You got to move quick, but take that second, look through the MLS listing and start to make sure there's no details. And that's our job as a realtor too, that we're going through to say we know what our client likes and what they want. But it's always good before we get to that point where we're rocking and rolling to check that out.
Do that research for sure. All right, perfect. I think that's a good first step. So that's our prep portion. So now we're getting into the fact that we're at the house and we're going to start right inside. So the first thing that you want to look at...
Do we have anything? Kayla goes, tried to talk Jason into a cliff house. And I lost it. And then he reintroduced me to our youngest child. Yeah. Yeah. She's
good point. Good point. And sometimes, again, they're not in the listing. So it's a good idea to chat with your agent about it to see... hey, how's the backyard? Is it flat? Or really just taking a look at that Google Earth is a good idea too.
Yes.
Perfect.
Okay, so now we pull up to the house.
We are in the house.
Now, there's two different schools of thought. You can either go inside first or outside first.
All right, I'm done.
So we're gonna go inside, but if you are like, listen, all I care about is the outside. All I care about is land. All I care about is view. Go to the place that's most important to you, because if that doesn't work, there's no point in going into the rest of the house.
Yeah.
So if you're like, I care, like I love my outside, but I really care about, I want the kitchen, I want the living room, I want the playroom, like that's important to me. So I would go inside first, but somebody else might have, the land. And I mean, the land's really important to me too. So
yeah.
I'm just needy.
I wasn't going to say it, but.
Okay. So we're inside. So what are the steps we do when we're walking through a home?
Yeah. So typically we're going to let, the buyer lead the tour to some degree, because they're going to go where it's most important to them. So a lot of people will head straight to the kitchen. And it's really difficult, but we often encourage them, try and look past the furniture. It might not be your style, and that's something that's so difficult for a lot of people. They love it, and then that's all they think about, or they hate it, and that's all they think about. So it's really important to look past that. And really just start looking, let's say we're in the kitchen first. There's a ton to look at.
Yes.
You're going to look at the appliances, and it's really important that you don't just look at them and say, oh, it's gas or electric oven. You really want to look inside. Is it clean? How has it been maintained? Things like that.
Because majority of the time, those appliances will convey with the house.
Yep.
So people say, oh, I don't want to look in their fridge. That's weird. Well, that could be your fridge. So it's tough sometimes, like you feel a little awkward about it, but you have to know you have permission to open up the cupboards. You have permission to open up the appliances. Now, if they do not convey, if they're not in the listing, then that's when we'll talk about that. But most of the time, the kitchen appliances are included. So we want to look in those. How old are they? Do they just look really nice? And maybe the oven's really, rough on the inside.
Ugh.
So you start to think about those things with appliances, with cupboards. They could be old, but are they in great shape and do they pull out really well, or are they floppy, or are they stuck? Uh-huh. All those things, you just look at how beautiful they look, and that's where we always joke about flipped houses, is it could be this really old thing, but they put all this white paint on it and these nice new handles, but then you open it, it's like,
you're like, I need my fork.
And you don't think about it until later. So we want to set you up so that you know all the information that you're going in with.
Definitely. So definitely open up cabinets, open up the appliances, make sure they're what you think they are. Also, just look at the layout of the kitchen. Is there an eat-in? Is there a formal dining space? How does that suit your family? Do you need more open concept? And is it kind of blocked off where if your kids were eating their cereal in the morning and you were making lunch, you would be able to see it or something like that too.
And I think the key with this is Abby had mentioned to look past the furniture and look past the decorations, because there are people that are phenomenal at decorating. Uh-huh. And it's like, oh, you're just blinded by that. That our job as agents is to really take you to be like, what would you look like in here? What would your kids look like in here? What would your family look like in here? What would you and your spouse look like in here? Like, how would you live in it? And how would your furniture that you have, or if you want to buy new furniture, how would that go in with that house?
Yep, for sure. Mm-hmm. So that's really important too. And then, you know, look under the sinks, things like that. Make sure there's nothing leaking or corroding or, you know, broken or anything like that. So that's really the key in the kitchen too, is open everything up and make sure that it's as you would expect it to be.
And as you open things up, you can see like what kind of storage they have. And you'll see when we talk about this from the seller side, that's why we care so much about this. Because from the seller side, that we're encouraging buyers to be doing that. What kind of storage, where, and we always say when we see a lot of like cereal boxes on the top of the fridge, what does that tell you? It means there's not a lot of storage. So you really want to like look at that as a way to say, okay, how would I live here?
Yeah, for sure. That's always something we tell our sellers is clear off the fridge. There's plenty of space. And one thing that I kind of went past because I got really excited about the kitchen was make sure that when you're walking through, you're looking at the floors, of course, the ceiling, the windows, all of those things, because that's sometimes where you can find those signs of deferred maintenance. You know, is there a stain on the ceiling from a leak from the bathroom upstairs? Are windowsills broken or window seals broken where you have that condensation between the two panes?
Exactly.
Is the floor lifting where it maybe wasn't quality floor? You know, really looking at kind of all of the elements.
Because you are so excited about this beautiful house. You're walking in and that's all you're looking at. You're not looking for those things. And again, that is our job as agents to be able to say, hey guys, this is what I'm seeing. I see a little bit over there. I wonder if that's right where the bathroom
probably
is.
Bathroom.
I don't think it's the roof. I think it's going to be a bathroom, but let's dig more into that. Yeah. As opposed to us never even thinking about it, and then we're not able to, you know, kind of handle that.
Exactly.
And decide what to do from it.
Exactly.
Perfect. Okay, so once we get through the kitchen,
then we're going to go to the living room. Living room is next. So you kind of alluded to this, but we'll just recap it really quick. Making sure that you have an idea of where your furniture would fit.
Yes.
That's
yes.
huge. We went through a house with one of our clients and there was a sliding glass door on one side of the living room, beautiful windows that looked out to the awesome yard, a fireplace, and then on this side it was like open to the kitchen. So we really sat there and we're like, how would any of your stuff fit in here? Because they had it staged really nicely, so it looked fine. But when you really sat back and thought about it, you said, I have a sectional couch. I can't block the windows. I can't block the sliding glass door. I can't block the fireplace. So where would my stuff go?
Right, right. And you don't want to buy a house around your furniture, you know?
Yeah.
But it's just one more thing to think about. It's one more thing to say, how is it staged versus how would I actually live in it?
Perfect.
So I think the other thing too with the living room is to make sure that you're seeing how it's connected with the kitchen and how it's connected with other parts, because your living room is this place where you're really going to be. Living room, family room, you know, all of those places are where people spend the majority of their time. So how are things connected? What would dad cooking in the kitchen be with mom in the living room? Like what would those conversations look like? And how does that go?
All right. Perfect.
So after the living room, we'll go over, up, wherever we're going to go, to the bedrooms. What are the things we need to look at in the bedrooms?
So really, again, just making sure, first and foremost, how would my stuff fit in here? Mm-hmm. And bedrooms, especially, you know, I see this a lot with kids' rooms, is they've got their bed, they've got the dresser, they've got the toy thing, they've got the desk. They do have all of these pieces. So it's really important that you're looking at the full picture, not just, oh, this will be big enough, but where would my stuff, my kids' stuff go, and how would it really fit into the space?
Exactly. And then we also think about closet space. What's unique in the bedrooms is you need to make sure, okay, well, if it's a master, what kind of closet space for my kids? Do they need a lot? Well, if I want this to be my forever home and I'm going to have teenagers in here, or if I'm downsizing, I actually don't really need a lot of space, this is perfect. But you see how the closet spaces are in each room, and that's really important. The other thing with bedrooms is to think about the layout of the bedroom. So we have situations where, and I talk a lot about family because that's where my brain is, but a lot of times the kids don't, you don't want your kids to be on a different floor than you. Sometimes you do want your kids to be on a different floor than you, but you start to see, okay, I think it's really important that, you know, the master bedroom's over here so that we have a little bit of privacy compared to the three other bedrooms, or if you're all in the mix, or one's upstairs and downstairs, what's the proximity of the bedrooms, what is the size of them, to make sure that the family kind of fits and the layout works for that.
Perfect. And one thing too that I see is, you know, making sure you look at the window treatments too.
Oh, yeah.
Was something that we hadn't talked about yet, but basically those can add up, you know, especially if you have the nice ones that move up and down and all around, and you think, okay, there's two bedrooms in each room, there's four bedrooms, that can add up. So looking at the window treatments and seeing if those will work for you too is something that can save a few bucks when you move in.
And again, something that we'll talk about at the end, but those are the things that we need to keep in mind when we talk about negotiating.
Yeah.
So the last thing that we talked about in here, when it comes to bedrooms, was that this is your time where you might be upstairs and you might be able to get a good look at the roof. Yes. Now, if it's a box colonial, you're not going to be able to, but sometimes with especially older houses or non-traditional houses, you might be able to get a look at the roof. So as this leads us to our discussion outside, you can start thinking about roof and windows and all of those things and what they look like from the inside.
Perfect.
So is there anything else inside?
Perfect.
Oh, basement.
Basement.
We have to go to the basement.
Basement. And with baths, I think it's pretty similar too. Yeah. You know, size, storage, proximity to things that are important, things like that. But let's get down to the basement because it's so funny. We, you know, live in a world where other states don't have basements. And so I think a lot of people, whether you're moving in from out of town,
hi Ben,
you might not know, you know, why is a basement important or whatever it might be. So it's really important that you go down there. And that's the structure of the house. That's what really gives it the support and the foundation and everything. So you want to make sure that's strong. That's important to take a look down there.
So the first thing we look for when we're going down in the basement is we sniff and we smell. And this time of year, guys, like my dehumidifier is cranking. Like I don't know how many more times, like it's insane. So you have to think, what does it smell like? Does it feel like there's water that has come in? Does it feel really humid? Yep. And does it smell musty? So that's so important to start to get you that feel for it. Do you see 15 dehumidifiers around and you're like, or do you just see that smells like radon down here? Yes. So smell is so, so important when we're in the basement. What else is important after we look past kind of like the musty and making sure that it feels dry downstairs?
Yeah. And we always joke, we offer free smell tests. So we'll come over and smell your house. But because a lot of times you get that commercial about the nose blind.
Yes.
Which if you're going down to your basement every day or whatever it might be, you might not know. So we do offer free sniff tests. But when you're in the basement, you also want to look at how are they storing things. Are they storing things up in, you know, storage containers because they don't feel comfortable putting it on the ground where they might be water?
Which is a sign that perhaps there was previous water.
Right. They have everything up, or do they have all their boxes on the ground? And they're like, we're good.
And it's like cardboard boxes and like electronics down there. And those are just small indications of, has there been, so not only does it smell, but you look to see how they storage, and then you look along the edges too. Like, do you see sometimes there is, you know, maybe old spaces that may have been finished and you see some water damage? Those are great things that we can then take to say, hey, when did that happen? We can look in the property condition disclosure, which is a document that the seller fills out to tell the buyer all that they know about the house, if there was previous flooding and all of those things. So you're able to use those kind of, just when you're looking, what are the things that you're looking for to see if there's anything that, you know, we need to be aware of when we're writing and preparing the offer, and that may sway you from buying the house or not.
Yep. And we'll talk more about water when we get outside. Yes. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. But also you want to look at the mechanics. You know, where is the furnace? How is it located? Because I'm going on a tangent here, but also
tangent.
What? We never do that. If you want to finish the basement and the furnace is in a location that would make that really difficult, you'd have to move it. But also you want to look at the ages. How have they been maintained? Is there a whole thing from your HVAC company that says it's been serviced regularly? That is awesome. Or is there nothing at all and we need to do a little bit more research on it?
I love that. I love that. And I tell you, the mechanics and how well they've been maintained is a really good indicator of how the whole home has been maintained. Good so point. Making mm-hmm. sure that you're seeing those and you're really looking at that. We've had people who went through and didn't even know it was a tankless water system, which is a really cool feature that a lot of buyers love, but we didn't even know to put value on that because we just had no idea until we got down there and we saw it too. So you'll start to think of those. I think that's it in the basement.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
That's perfect. So make sure you're looking at those mechanics. You're looking at the walls and everything like that, and you're really, smelling and feeling it to make sure the basement's nice and dry.
Right. And the thing we didn't mention is foundation cracks, that you should be looking along with the foundation to also see not just if there's moisture or anything coming in, but also if there's any signs of cracking. There are okay cracks. We have structural engineers.
Yeah, we are not structural engineers, but we have people that we can recommend or send pictures to or something like that.
Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of new builds out there. You know, if you live in them, you've seen cracks, and the builder's just like, it just settled. And it's like, what is a concern? What's not a concern? And when we see those, we can make sure that we bring them to the agent and potentially even to the builder and try to get some more information so we know if it's a concern or not.
Yep, good point. Okay, so let's go outside.
Let's do it. All right. So we've fallen in love with the inside. Everything's great. Now we go outside.
Yes.
The first thing that we look at typically is the roof.
Yep.
So we're going out and we're seeing what the roof looks like. Now again, the property condition disclosure typically has an age of the roof, when it was redone, if it's one layer, if it's two layers. But an agent, our job is to know this stuff. Like, it looks a little old, or that looks to be in great shape. So you do not have to know the age. It's just making sure that it's on your radar to check it out.
Right. And you can typically look with your eyes. You know, a lot of times
you don't have to bring your ladder along.
Yeah, no, you can say, okay, those look a little faded, or I can tell that shingle is lifted, or there's moss, on the roof, things like that. So we're keeping an eye on, we know the age most of the time. We know if it's the first or second layer, and then we're really just looking with our eyes to see what we see. Of course, an inspector will go through all of these things, but this is what we're just looking at, during the showing.
Exactly. And then once you, as you're up with the roof, you're also looking at the chimney. Are that, how's the brick? If it's cement, like, do we see any cracks? Do we see anything that's a concern? Do we see it tilting? Like, we just want to make sure that we have our eyes on those.
Perfect. And then you're also looking at the siding and the gutters too. What type of siding is it?
Mm-hmm.
Is it vinyl, which, typically is really low maintenance? Great. Or is it cedar, aluminum, something different where, okay, it looks good now, but we might just need to budget that we need to paint in the next 5 to 7 years or whatever it is. So looking at that and looking really at the condition, because the outside of your house is really what keeps everything inside protected. So you want the siding to be in good shape. You want the gutters to be in good shape, the roof, all of those things.
And we've looked at the windows from the inside. Now we're looking at the windows from the outside too. If you are getting a government-backed loan, like a FHA loan or USDA or a VA loan, any signs of chipping paint is signs of deferred maintenance. So we really need to make sure that there's none of that on this house if you are getting a government-backed loan. And this is the time that we're going around and doing that. Because if we do see any issues, we can write and negotiate in, hey, we want this done before the bank comes out for their appraisal.
And even we just had a seller who we got a conventional loan and they cited chipping paint. The bank did. First time I'd ever seen that. So, and it was on the garage. So sometimes it's just not a bad idea to, make sure that you're well aware of that. And I talked about gutters a little bit, but making sure that the downspouts are going away from the house.
Ah.
Making sure that there's no standing water, because that's huge. That's what gets into your basement, can create issues with water, foundation, structural issues, things like that. So making sure the water is going away from the house.
Away from the house. And in the way you can just see it is just by the dirt. What does the grade look like? Is it sloped away? Is it sloped towards? Is there a patio that's in place that's sloped that has just naturally kind of settled? And that can then say, you know what? It did smell kind of musty. It did look dark in that corner of the foundation.
That's probably why.
And that's exactly why. So it's situations where I'm like, there's a giant puddle in here and I have no idea why. It to us, if we know exactly why, then it's okay, listen, I'm not as intimidated by this. We might be able to work around it. So it's really you're putting two and two together.
Yeah. We see that a lot where it's like, oh yeah, the gutter's broken.
Yeah.
And that's why there's some moisture. It needs a downspout. Yep, exactly. It could be bigger issues, without a doubt, but most of the time we see that there's a reason for that.
Yes, yes. Hi Howard. Hi Todd. Good to see you guys.
Hi everyone.
Hi. Marin, do you know that you were a potential tag, aka we must look alike?
We get that all the time. It's mostly our mom, but
now
Marin, you're the fourth
friend girl.
Fourth friend girl.
So, and then when you're outside too, you're also going to be looking at some of the amenities of the outside. So not just what's, you know, structurally important to the house, but also the shed, the patio, the deck. Mm-hmm. Things like that, the fun parts.
And now it's beautiful and you get to see all of those. But if you might be watching these in the winter, you might not think, okay, well, I've got to see them. And what we always suggest to our sellers is make sure anything that's a nice feature is getting cleared off. But if you don't see it and if the seller didn't clear it off, start to make sure you're asking questions about those just to see is there value under the snow and under the leaves and under all of that.
And also thinking about the privacy of your backyard. Right now, the trees are full. Life is good. The sun is shining. The grass is green. But in December, those leaves will fall. Unfortunately, Mother Nature, that is a fact. So thinking about, I know we don't want to think about it, but thinking about that is important too, because what's behind those trees? What is behind those trees? Is it an industrial building or something like that that you might not want to be looking at? And just the reality of, is it as private as I think it is all year round?
That's such a great point. And the last thing outside, so great. The last thing outside is just gardens and maintenance. Mm. You know, it could be where it's, wow, this is a lot of mulch and this is, I mean, I don't think you're not going to buy a house because of mulch and you can do those things. Mm-hmm. But again, it's one more thing to keep on your radar that if you want to have a successful showing, you want to make sure you're thinking about all these things.
Perfect. All right.
All right. So we've gone inside. We've gone outside. Now we're done with the showing. Yep. What do we do after the fact to make sure it's a successful showing? Hey, Josh.
Yes. So this is where our team agent is going to talk with the buyers and really say, what do you think? Do you want to make an offer? Because that is where we really discuss and start the conversation about pros and cons.
Mm-hmm. And the reason we want to talk about pros and cons, even if you're like, I don't like this house, is because we want to then know, how do we tweak your search? Yeah. Is there some way that we can make sure that we know? Because if someone sends us a house, like I want to see 123 Main Street, we're not just saying, okay, go, we're going to go. We're going to be looking through it to say, yes, I think this is going to be a great house. Or sometimes we're even the ones sending them to you to say, hey, we want you to come check out 123 Main Street. That together we are looking at this criteria before we even go out there, not just to save the seller's time, to save our time, to save your time. We want to make sure that every showing is really worthwhile, and we do so by, after we have a showing, to potentially tweak it to say, yeah, this is a house you definitely want to see, or hey, listen, the bedroom situation in here was a little bit unique, or hey, look, I did Google Earth, I know this backyard.
Yeah. And most of the time our agents, and we've been in the house too,
so
maybe we've seen it in the past, we went by the open house, we went by the broker's open house, so we've seen it where we can say, yes, this house is stunning, but actually the basement is soaking wet or something like that. You know, we were just talking about that. So I'm thinking about it. Or I know you said you need four bedrooms. Well, the fourth bedroom is actually an office and it's tiny.
Yeah.
And we can kind of, because we also don't want you to be disappointed when you go to. So we're doing a lot of that research up front. But if they do say, yes, we want to write an offer, that's when, and we'll get into this with another Friday with Friends, but this is where we're going to go through the pros and cons and say, what did you like? What didn't you like? Oh, remember, the furnace was old.
Yes.
So we're going to need to budget that. Or there was some landscaping that we needed to adjust so it sloped away from the house. We're going to look at all of that together.
Mm-hmm. And to be able to say, what can we do to protect you? So listen, prior, you know, during the inspection, we want to have a structural engineer come through.
Right.
We want a clean bill of health on the furnace. You know, like we put those things in the offer so that we're going in as strong as we can negotiating and we know what we're working with.
Yeah, that's a great point. If we see maybe one of those cracks in the basement that we're not 100% sure on, since that's we're not structural engineers to say, okay, we want that extra bit of comfort, we're going to put that right into the offer so you're protected.
Yeah. And, you know, I think, too, when we are thinking about writing offers on houses, like, no house is perfect. Mm-hmm. There's always going to be something that maybe you wish was different or, you know, anything like that. So I think it's so important to say, how in love with this house are you? And it's like, listen, this is what was great, great, not so great. And then we as agents can say, guys, listen, you're at 80% that you're in love with this house. Let's crank it. Or we're saying, listen, you're kind of in love with this house. Let's put in an offer and see where it goes. Mm-hmm. So we can help gauge how aggressive we feel that you should be in order to get the house based on the pros and the cons. Because there's going to be pros in every house. There's going to be cons in every house. It's just helping us kind of measure that so we know how to advise you to make sure if this is your dream house,
we're winning. Like exactly. That kind of mentality.
Exactly. The only thing you really can do is move the house.
Yes. We can make adjustments, but as long as it's in like the location, that's why everyone always says location, location, location. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, all right.
Well, that's what we got. So, what we talked about today is how to make sure that you are getting the most out of every single showing you're doing. In this market especially, you do not have time to do a second showing. You have to know when you're going into it so that you're seeing everything, you're thinking about everything, yes. So that you know at the end of that showing, am I going to write an offer, am I not? And if I am, how aggressive am I going to be? And if I'm not, how can I tweak it so that I can be closer to the house that I actually want? Perfect. So, we went through what to do before, what to do during the showing, and what to do after. So, please share this with anyone you think that this could help so that we can make their process as seamless as possible. And of course, thank you for tuning in to
Friday with Friends.
Friday with Friends is our opportunity to talk about what's going on in the market so that if you or anyone you know has any real estate needs, we would love to be your realtor of choice and we would love the opportunity to help. So any questions or anyone we can help, always let us know.
Comment below or reach out to us. We are not hard to find.
No, we're not hard to find. Have a great
one. Bye, guys.